So that's how she came here. She's saying that her experience as a refugee in India is like she's been open to a whole new world in terms of Tibetan history.
One of his other friends, he and himself, their conditions were really, really, really bad. So they were brought down to Sikkim again, and their feet were amputated.
Well, the one that's really, really struck me is the one that of this person called Taga. He came through Tibet and he was caught in a snowstorm, and during that period, he lost one of his friends. And even though his feet were all had frostbite, he carried that body down to Kathmandu, and there he was. His legs had to be amputated, and he was helped by this foundation called the American Himalaya Foundation. And now he's here with us. He's training in the Tangka Pinyin School.
Kumbhakwa.
Ratul. He was a monk in Tibet, in the Ratu monastery in Tibet. Ani?
No. Okay,
he was involved in one of the uprisings on Kechu Kepke. On 5th March 1988, he was involved in this uprising. He was a participant in that uprising. That was the first major demonstration that was ever done in Tibet after 1987. So after 1987, the crackdown in 1988 was the second largest one that the demonstrations were ever held. And during that demonstrations, the Chinese police, they threw tear gas and nerve gas, all those things. So most of the people, they sort of split up and ran away, and they were, and so he and some of his monk friends were up on top of the Chogang monastery on the terrace, so they had escaped there. So in fact they were up on the Chogang terrace, and they were in fact hiding there from the security forces, and when the security forces came, then and in fact the Chinese came up to where he was hiding, he and his friends were hiding, and they broke the doors and they asked them to come out. So all these monks, they just went out in one big force, and the Chinese, they sort of hit everybody. Most probably you must have seen this footage before, many times, and maybe he was one of them. And after that, he doesn't remember anything because he was clubbed by his police. And and he was taken to another jail in Chushu, where he was kept in prison for about two years and 2 months.
How old were you at the time?
He was 14 years old.
And tell me what you remember of that experience.
During the demonstration, it looks like he lost his one of his foot was fractured. So, and whenever he used to see a Chinese policeman, he had a feeling that was totally different. He was always feel angry and would not like to see a policeman.
And so, once you were out, how did you get out of prison, or how did that work out?
Ani kanda saiv ne kaza nge chushu ne kanda lo ni da da ni da ra an tene kanda stem be ne
dine lo ni da da ni za ne ngal le le je ne kombada dine shung le ga da dine love this rather than the Zuju Mari. So, I'll dig.
And after 2.5 years in prison, he was released. And he was not able to enroll in the monastery back again, and he was not able to get any work. And the only option that he had left was to go back to his home and stay there with him with his folks. And during all that period, when I was in the prison, he was not given any medication at all, and he was still limping, and he was, you know, was walking with the aid of a walking stick. The message that he wants to put forward to the rest of the people who are watching this film is to believe the facts of what's going on in Tibet, and to take this very seriously and put appeals to the UN.
He's saying that people in the
free world, those who have a chance to visit Tibet should visit Tibet. He wants them to visit Tibet, but not as a group, but visit there as individuals, and do not fall under the sway of the Chinese tourism. And they visit Tibet independently and see the facts for themselves. Don't visit the big cities, but go to the real remote areas. Go to the main villages, and you'll see the exact truth as to what's going on there. And he wants the people of the free world to at least have that experience, then come out of Tibet and say, okay, well, what is Tibet now? And because the picture that the Chinese are giving is not very, you know, rosy to the Tibetan people. And to the outside world, it's just a matter of propaganda, that's all it is. So if you want to know, please visit Tibet as an independent.
In 1992,
first August, there was a big celebration, you know, celebrating the Chinese in Tibet. And during that period, he was involved in this putting up pamphlets and posters. And at the end of that month, in August, he was caught by the Chinese. And he was put into prison for 6 months in Loka. And he was sentenced for 4 years and 6 months rigorous imprisonment. And he was taken to Tabji Lera. Then he was brought to Lhasa. And Loshi Devre. And he was there in prison for 4 years, 6 months. He's saying when he was taken to Tabji for 6 months, in fact there were two of his friends also with him, so they were all involved in this thing, and during the 6 months they were rigorously tortured, and they were put in confinement cells, and they were questioned, interrogated. Like, there was no time for interrogations. Like, you know, they could come at midnight and they would wake you up. And since there were three of them, each one of them maybe had a different story to tell, and the Chinese would interrogate at all times. And they used to use electric batons, and they used to tie them up, hang them up, beat them, and make them kneel on cold floors, and put stones underneath their knees. And these are some of the ways that they would torture to get things out. And he's saying in Tabji prison, he was for almost two years he was put into a he was made to work in a greenhouse where he and some of his friends were given the responsibility of planting vegetables. And they had to sell that vegetable as well, and they had to to earn a certain number of a limited number of money, and if they were not able to accumulate that, they would again be questioned and beaten and tortured and all those things. And lonely jail ani
lonely jail ati no kasoi da manju mi senda la da ngengu chi gros mi senda la jun da ti mi khonda sen la jun da ngdu sigri le jun da manju da chepsi mo ju je da manju chol lam chu do se je manju chepsi chum ba manju ru ga di na la khyon do mi ngi la sir.
Okay, he's saying in that prison there were like 200 about more than 200 political prisoners.
But
basically in that prison there were more than 1,000 prisoners
there. Out
of which 500 were mostly monks and male prisoners.
And the
torture, one of the most that his experience was that, you know, during the warm days, they would all be made to parade in the grounds for hours on end, and asked to stay out in the sun, right, and expose their bodies to the sun. And during the winter times, they would make them put waters on the floor, throw waters on the floor, the cold floors, and ask them to sit down on the water. Tangwo mi di ming.
Tangwo mi di ming la sangye tembe lo.
Sangye tembe.
Che di ming kesan tutup.
Kesan tutup. There were two of his monks friends. The first was sangye tembe and jela kesan tutup. The other one was kesan tutup. The first one he said was kwan yidu tangwo. He was beaten because of his political views and of his political statements that he had made, and he died. There were two people of his friends who died in the prison. Other one was taken for interrogations, and when he came back after 3 hours, he was basically half dead, and they could not administer any medicine or any of those things, so he died also. So two of his friends died that way in the prison. He's saying, coming in exile and talking to you in this medium, he feels very, very happy, because he feels that if he was in Tibet, like many others who are still in Tibet, they would not be able to say a word as he is able to express what he has, you know, about his life in Tibet. So he wants the people to know that whatever he said is just a very, very, you know, a short synopsis of what, you know, what actually has happened. In fact, it is more than that, and he wants people to know that it is true. And so through this medium he wants them to learn about his story and the facts of the story, and to be more supportive of the cause.
The Chinese took their old family under their they arrested them. The Chinese arrested them and took them to prison for 17 years. So on that time, her father died
in prison.
He was in prison for 18 years.
She said she has got a 9-year-old son. He was also tortured by Chinese together with her. They dragged him with them, with her, and they took her to the place over there. They didn't give them any food, so he died due to this starvation. She controlled herself under such circumstances. She feels that this is one day or the other she can meet His Holiness the Dalai Lama over here in India.